Today, we would like to talk to you about the struggle for equality for women in the film industry, specifically Hollywood films. We will discuss with you the skewed representations and stereotyping of women in films across the span of film history, and how these stereotypes have paved the way to a hostile environment for women actresses and has limited characterization of women, especially women in leading roles. Behind the camera, women only make up a minuscule fraction of those who influence, input, and ultimately decide on how women are portrayed on screen, and consequently, this lack of women directors, writers, and producers allows for the industry to passively agree to the misogyny and women-centered violence off-screen and in greater society. Without representation behind camera, there is little power to change the decisions made that produce on-camera results. We will then analyze how male domination in powerful leading roles leads to off-screen workplace harassment. With men being portrayed as more important and more powerful, movies are inadvertently contributing to the societal idea that women are unimportant, passive, and are supposed to be dominated and controlled by men. By depicting women in passive, sexualized roles, film is mass-producing male power and female submissivity. In recent years, however, we will show you current movements like Me Too and Time's Up that aim to stop harassment and encourage better representation in media, and we will discuss what the future holds for women in film.
The representation of women in cinema has come a significant distance in recent decades. In order to see this, we need to return to how we got into this mess to begin with. It was far before this happened. This was caused by decades of reinforcing the idea of women as objects of male desire. If that role wasn't called for in a film, there was always a stereotypical gender role that fit the bill.
Things arguably could have been much worse if it weren't for a production code studios self-imposed in 1930, although it wasn't actively enforced until 1934. Pre-code movies, as they're called, were made before code was enforced and are ripe with explicit female exploitation. This scene, aptly called Pet in the Park, from the musical Gold Diggers of 1933, is an excellent example.
During the Second World War, although still fraught with male gaze in characters and cinematography, women found greater independence on screen.
I'm getting married, Walter, and I'm also getting as far away from the newspaper business as I can get.
Interestingly, during this time, there are many movies where women are in non-traditional employment roles, yet they're yearning to throw it all away to become a housewife, such as in the 1940 movie His Girl Friday.
That's why I'm quitting. I want to go someplace where I can be a woman.
After the war, any progress that was made was entirely lost and women returned to the kitchen. The repression brought about a new woman in film called the femme fatale. These very dangerous yet irresistible women were poison to the film's leading man. Notable women in these roles were Barbara Stanwyck in Double Indemnity and Anne Blythe in Mildred Pierce. The queen, however, was Lauren Bacall, who got her start with Humphrey Bogart in the 1946 film The Big Sleep.
Well, how'd you happen to pick out this place?
Maybe I wanted to hold your hand.
Oh, that can be arranged.
As women were shoved back into their place in society, stereotypical representation festered, leading to Doris Day and Rock Hudson in the pathetically sexual and blatantly sexist Pillow Talk.
Get your clothes on.
You get out of here.
We're going to my apartment.
I've seen it.
You'll see it again. Now put your clothes on.
I won't.
Are you getting out of that bed or am I coming in after you?
You wouldn't dare. Oh! Oh, how dare you! Oh, you put me down! I said put me down!
Even even in the modern era, with the advancement of women's rights and female empowerment, there is still a wide array of negative portrayals and stereotypes of women present in films. A recent USC study analyzing 1,000 screenplays found that female characters were portrayed far less than men, having less than half the number of characters as men. In addition, the study found that female characters were shown as less dynamic, expressing less negative emotion overall. Another major discrepancy between men and women in film is the age gap between male leads and their female counterparts. Female characters are, on average, 5 years younger than their male co-stars, emphasizing the stereotypical views of youth and beauty for women. This graph from a Vulture article reveals that over the 20 years of his career, Denzel Washington never had a female counterpart over the age of 35, even as he was reaching age 60. This age gap is significant because viewers tend to associate older age with more intelligence and maturity, attributing these characteristics to men rather than their female counterparts. Another common stereotype of women is that of the career woman, who is often depicted as overly ambitious or obsessed with her career to the point of destroying her personal life. These women are shown as successful in the professional field, but failing in terms of relationships or family life. Career women are often competent, but heartless, rude, or overly promiscuous. A significant example of this is Meryl Streep's character in The Devil Wears Prada. While an expert in the field of fashion, her marriage is failing and she comes across as cold and cruel. Another common portrayal of women in film is the image of the aggressive female protagonist. According to the Journal of Research on Sex Roles, this motif is meant to challenge stereotypically feminine gender roles for women. But instead, this protagonist role shows women as both attractive and aggressive, increasing expectations of women to behave in not only traditional feminine ways, but to also exhibit traditional masculine traits as well. When audiences repeatedly see these same values depicted on screen, they begin to internalize these views of women. Acknowledging the media's representation of women may help us rethink ageism, stereotypes, and the gender expectations of women in our culture.
We cannot discuss women in Hollywood without a huge consideration for those working behind the camera. Women have been involved in the films since its genesis. Here's a picture of Alice Guy Blanche looking confident as she is the first to make a fiction narrative film. This is Leni Riefenstahl, the woman behind one of the most influential pieces of propaganda for the Nazi Party, Triumph of the Will. Previous to two propaganda films, she made a film called The Blue Light. So why are women so underrepresented in the film industry today, and what are the effects of this underrepresentation? This has us scratching our heads too. The green bars on this graph represent the women involvement in film compared to men, as the purple bars. Note the large difference. Check out the high percentages stating the lack of female influence in the top 250 films. Women are rarely represented in film awards as well. In 2009, Kathryn Bigelow was the first woman to win an Academy Award for Best Director. Notice in this photo that her female features are quite downplayed. Just Google simple behind-the-scenes jobs like here is famous cinematographers and see who pops up. There's no doubt that men represent the majority. This affects how men and women are represented on screen. When women are on screen, they are often hypersexualized or misrepresented. This scene from Just Go With It demonstrates the divided way in which each gender is represented. This leads to embedded structure of gender indifference that exists. Another example is Blue is the Warmest Color, a movie about two young women in a relationship. It is known for its graphic sex scenes diminishing love. Even the poster alone has some sexual influence. In contrast, Lady Bird, directed by Greta Gerwig, is a movie about a young woman coming of age. The movie focuses on her relationship with her mother and her need for independence. Note the strong stance that these two women are holding in the film. Women face the structural hierarchy that exists in the film industry and are kept stagnant with gender status and representation of masculinity versus femininity in society. They must smash through these organizational processes that exist to maintain gender hierarchy.
Next, we will discuss the sexualization of women in Hollywood through both on-screen portrayals and off-screen expectations. First off, let us discuss how the on-screen portrayals of women in Hollywood are often held to artificial and unattainable standards of beauty. In this image of Mariah Carey, one can see a multitude of areas enhanced artificially using computer programs. Many of the areas which were enhanced, like skin tone, hair volume, waist, and jawline, imply a sexual undertone. What is shocking is how disproportionately this need to artificially enhance one's image is skewed towards women. Just one Google search for celebrity before and after touch-up photos reveals countless female celebrities, but very few men, Clearly, the social pressure to obtain an unattainable standard of beauty is burdened mostly by women. This artificial sexualization is important to remember when we consider how many women see celebrities as role models. In extreme circumstances, such idolization of fake images can lead to eating disorders, as young women attempt to reach the unattainable look of the famous individual they look up to. Next, we will look at how the on-screen portrayal of women has been sexualized. Women on screen are often portrayed through sexual mannerisms, objectified for their bodies, and subject to the control of overpowering masculinity. The best example of this portrayal comes to us in the form of female villains in the Bond movies. Despite having a multitude of directors and casts across time, all Bond movies feature a somewhat similar female villain. The archetype is as follows. Foreign, scantily clad, skinny, in makeup, and ultimately falling prey to Bond's irresistible masculinity. Here's the 1985 Bond seducing the Soviet villain, Pola Ivanova, in a jacuzzi. The sexual undertone is apparent. Here, in another act of seduction, is the aptly named villainous Octopussy. Finally, from 1964's Goldfinger, there is Pussy Galore. The sexual exploitation of these characters is glaringly obvious and serves to reinforce the stereotypes of women as sexually vulnerable individuals able to be seduced and controlled by more powerful men. The masculine Bond, representative of good, not only prevails over but conquers the feminine evil through the act of sexual seduction. Even in films with strong female leads, such as Kill Bill, we see a sexualization of the female form and a submission to a masculine dominating power, suggesting femininity, no matter how powerful, must always suffer under masculinity. The final point in regards to the sexualization of women in Hollywood refers to the double standard of the expectation of appearance for female celebrities when compared with men. When female celebrities are caught in public not looking their absolute best, it instantly becomes that night's Hollywood news story. However, the same standard does not apply to men. At red carpet events, men all wear somewhat the same outfit, usually a tuxedo, while female celebrities are sexualized, objectified, judged, and valued for what they chose to wear and how they chose to wear it. Looking to the future, we are seeing signs of an improving environment for women in Hollywood. Take, for example, the film studio and the public's rejection of highly sexualized films like Louis C.K.'s I Love You, Daddy, and celebrities like Brad Pitt and Kate Winslet taking a public stance against the digital altering of photographs. In conclusion, the sexualization of women in Hollywood, both on and off screen, is without a doubt an important contributing factor to the existing masculine-dominated, feminine-hostile environment currently existing in Hollywood. Only through recognizing and responding to this fact can we hope to move towards gender equality in the film industry.
The constant sexualization of women on screen, combined with the lack of female representation off screen, results in exclusive and often dangerous conditions for women within the film industry. On October 5th, 2017, the New York Times released a story containing 3 decades worth of sexual harassment accusations against producer Harvey Weinstein. The story, culminating a 10-month investigation by the Times, contained vivid accusations from both well-known and unnamed women within the industry. Weinstein allegedly cornered the women, exposed himself, and offered career opportunities in exchange for sexual favors. In 2 months following the original New York Times story, more than 30 women came forward with accusations against Weinstein. He was fired from his own production company and blacklisted from nearly every aspect of his previously glamorous Hollywood life. The so-called Weinstein effect sparked a wave of sexual harassment accusations throughout the entertainment industry in the following months. Many prominent Hollywood men were exposed for their inappropriate behavior towards women, including Louis C.K., Kevin Spacey, and James Franco. On January 1, 2018, the New York Times published an open letter announcing the Time's Up movement. Founded by nearly 400 women throughout the entertainment industry, Time's Up launched to work alongside the Me Too movement to bring awareness to the unspoken frequency of sexual harassment. Time's Up provides a legal defense fund for victims of sexual harassment, acquired from donations from both celebrities and common citizens. As of February 2018, 1 month after its conception, Time's Up has raised $21 million and over 200 volunteer lawyers to protect the victims of harassment. In addition to the financial support, Time's Up created a significant social movement within the film industry simply by raising awareness. Beginning with the Golden Globes, every award show of 2018 has contained a unifying symbol of Time's Up, from an encouraged dress code to the official Time's Up pin worn by guests. On December 4th, 2017, Time magazine named the Silence Breakers as the 2017 Person of the Year. The accompanying story celebrated the Me Too movement, highlighted the entertainment celebrities who had spoken out regarding sexual harassment, and stood in solidarity with the countless women who experienced such harassment and remained nameless in fear of retribution.
Today we have discussed with you the oppression of women in Hollywood films and how a male-driven environment and female-disempowered environment has not only caused objectification, limitation, and underrepresentation of women on and off the camera, but how these behaviors influence sexual harassment and violence in and out of the film community. We recounted Hollywood's long history of male domination on the screen and how men are seen as powerful and women as passive in traditional Hollywood roles. There is no way in which women in media are seen as respectable, socially adept, and intelligent in the way men are portrayed on screen. These stereotypes we see limit and simplify women in a degrading way, and these portrayals affect our society as a whole through mass production of learned misogyny and glorification of women's bodies. We went behind the camera, where women only make up 18% of behind camera operations. We concluded that this lack of women behind the screen ultimately leads to a cycle of male dominance and misogyny in the film industry. It also affects the support and funding for women behind and on screen due to ageism that is apparent and rampant in the film industry. The betrayal of women in sexually submissive roles leads to a societal affirmation of the belief that women are simply objects for men's desire, and their purpose is to look good and please the male-dominated ideals in Hollywood. This thusly leads to physical and psychological harassment and violence against women in and beyond the screen, and affects women in our society as a whole. With all this being said, we concluded that positive action is now being taken place in Hollywood as we speak. Movements like Time Up and Me Too commit to ending workplace and other sexual violence towards women. The biggest shift we see now is a call to action to offer more challenging, less stereotyped roles to actresses on stage, and support and respect for the women who work behind the scenes as well. If we continue to demand better representation and we commit to ending sexual harassment, the future will only improve.